HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Team America, Patton, MacArthur, Marshall, Eisenhower, and the World They Forged by Robert L. O'Connell. Performed by Malcolm Hillgartner. Joe Kett, Jim Sterling, Peter Cracked, Gordon McCormick, and Jonathan Zhao. Five gentlemen who changed my life. Thanks. I'll go through those Germans like crap through a goose. George Patton. Young man, that bullet was not meant for me. Douglas MacArthur. I save my emotions for Mrs. Marshall. George Marshall. Make that 75% cold-blooded. Dwight Eisenhower's son, John, when asked to balance his father's open and sunny side and his calculating nature. America, fuck yeah! The cheer of the plush puppet U.S. special operators in the film Team America, after clearing Paris of terrorists and in the process knocking down the Eiffel Tower. A note before we begin. For maps depicting the strategic military operations discussed in the book, along with notes on the text, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/Team America. Introduction. There was once a real Team America, a military-industrial colossus engaged successively in what amounted to two World Series of warfare. A third was suspended indefinitely due to the prospect of mutual annihilation. Our country had many assets in these struggles, but among the most important was extraordinary military leadership, which got better and better until Team America forged a true murderer's row. George Patton, Douglas MacArthur, George Marshall, and Dwight Eisenhower. A string of warrior superstars unprecedented in military history. Probably, if they were in a position to do so, Caesar and Napoleon would point to themselves and their stellar henchmen and vociferously disagree. But in terms of the sheer magnitude of what they attempted and accomplished at such a critical point in human history, the transition from total warfare to strategic permafrost, it's pretty clear that the shadows cast by former lineups can't match the achievements of Team America, particularly these four superstars and the savvy managers who engage them around the world. Plainly, all of this requires further explanation. The idea of consistently comparing the struggles of the 20th century to a series of gigantic sporting events might strike some as absurd, even obscene. But as with any such artifice, it depends on how you look at it. For example, the matter of scale. On the one hand, the armies we will be considering numbered in the millions, which is inherently confusing, especially combined with military terminology unfamiliar to most. On the other, sports teams numbering in double digits more accurately approximate the scale in which key decisions are actually made in time of war, as does the push and pull of willful superstar athletes held in check and directed by managers with a larger view. Yet sports are not about killing, or at least haven't been since the Romans. This book is all about excessive killing, how that came to pass, and what our four superstars did about it. So the analogy works only if you are willing to embrace another analogy, that of the big leagues in hell. Here in the infernal majors, the score is kept mainly, though inaccurately since everybody cheats, through body counts. Combat is often one-on-one, but ganging up is always encouraged. As we shall see, alliance inter-squad scrimmages produced some of Team America's most impressive wins, courtesy of George Marshall and Dwight Eisenhower. In literal terms, at least, these were bloodless victories, but they were made in the context of the constantly gorier, corpse-littered environment of World War II. The game our four protagonists had devoted their lives to getting good at was getting worse and worse. Fortunately, As befit the hellish locale, the game itself was doomed, destined to be replaced by something even worse. Much worse, actually. But paradoxically much better. If hell could have a silver lining, this was it. The fact was that Western societies, and ultimately the rest of the world, had blundered into a logical trap so simple, yet so self-reinforcing, that it amounted to a feedback loop for warfare intensification, a demonic treadmill of destructiveness always accelerating and with no apparent way to get off. It began during the early stages of the French Revolution, when it was discovered that ordinary citizens, hastily assembled, armed, and trained, could make up for their military shortcomings with sheer enthusiasm, and in doing so, overcome the dispirited professionals of the ancient regime. This began with volunteers, but soon it was learned that the proposition basically held for those compelled to serve, so long as revolutionary fervor held and, later, Napoleon was around to lead them. Prior to this, armies had been very expensive and time-consuming to build and maintain. Now, very suddenly, the way was open for legions in the millions. The second jaw of the trap was formed and sprung during the American Civil War. In this case, it came in three forms: the telegraph, trains to transport troops, and rifled small arms with triple the accurate range of their predecessors. All were important, though not necessarily decisive, but it was their larger lesson that mattered. Technology must be relentlessly applied to the means of warfare. The results would prove appropriate and effective. When put in the hands of armies of ordinary citizens, those new means of warfare led to a series of ever-intensified bloodbaths, wars of such magnitude that they shook otherwise successful societies to their very foundations. Total war, periodic societal spasms, during which everything was devoted to destruction, was the outcome of this simple but lethal proposition. Around 100 million died prematurely during the first half of the 20th century, caught in this perfect trap. Then, without warning, the grand mechanism self-destructed by creating something much more terrible, but, in the end, far safer. Yet at the time, who knew? By any measure, for a civilian or soldier, this was tough ground to have crossed. Yet our four protagonists not only successfully traversed the first, truly uncharted part of the Cold War, they also directed the rest of us toward safety. They were far from perfect human beings, but they did basically represent the values of their countrymen in some very tough circumstances. All four exhibited remarkable adaptability, which was exactly what tumultuous times demanded, but they never lost their basic respect for human life in an environment devoted to slaughter. They played in a very rough league, yet they never truly disgraced themselves or us, not even George Patton. No superstar is remembered primarily for being a nice guy. It's achievements that matter. Since this is Team America, we'll group them together. The most audacious general, along with the best staff officer in the American Expeditionary Forces that finished off the Germans in 1918. The chief organizer of the U.S. Army in World War II, and that war's best field general. Its victors in both the European and Pacific theaters. The organizer and first commander of NATO, the father of the Marshall Plan to rebuild Western Europe, along with the creator of modern Japan. Two of the key architects of the U.S. nuclear arsenal, and one of the most successful presidents in American history. Heavy on the military side, perhaps, but these achievements also get at the point that these men, all soldiers, cast a long shadow over the events of their times. It's a shadow that lasted long after World War II, one so long that Ike left office profoundly worried about its military-industrial implications. That chimera of total war's imminence has passed. At the highest level of conflict, the environment has stabilized. And as this has transpired, it becomes possible to see our four protagonists and their ultimate significance in a clearer light. What stands out is how much they stood out. Among English speakers, World War II was largely an amphibious endeavor. Yet the U.S. Navy's key leaders were and remain completely overshadowed by the Army's four superstars. In large part, this was because they had the capacity to transcend their roles as purely military leaders and move into the realm of statecraft. Even Patton showed some diplomatic flair in North Africa, while Mac and Ike had no trouble more or less directing the fates of whole nations while very much in uniform. Also, it's important to note that doing this and getting away with it without arousing the wrath of superiors are two different things. For most of their careers, all four had to operate within the context of a rigid and potentially unforgiving military organization, one which, in some respects, was devoted to honing down outstanding personalities. Patton, MacArthur, Marshall, and Eisenhower were all deeply conditioned by their education and experiences as military officers. Without question, it was the essence of their personal identities. So it makes sense to study them and their evolution as part of one team. However ambitious each might have been, they thought of themselves as part of a team. But why four? All were born within the span of a decade, so the time frame would not change significantly by narrowing the focus to a more intensive study of a single individual. Yet this book is intended to cover a lot of history across a broad front, and it needs an equivalently varied cast of characters to propel the story beyond what could become a didactic swamp. But even if you did try to zero in on just one, the others would keep turning up, demanding our attention. Their lives and careers were, in fact, intertwined, like a giant braid in time. Except for Patton and Ike, a bromance that ended badly, none were truly friends. Yet they used each other brilliantly in a series of symbiotic relationships of increasingly greater consequence, the net effect of which was to give all a thorough schooling in the tricks of the trade. MacArthur was the first to emerge. The right parents, good luck, and his own bravery cast him far out in front of the group. But the other three, left way behind in rank and importance for decades, nonetheless took on education and at times responsibilities far beyond their actual professional grade, thereby preparing themselves and each other to become what they all were destined to be, generals. Being a general is important to consider at the outset, because to most of us they are a breed apart. In fact, they have to be. For ultimately a general must be prepared to face the prospect of convincing men to march to their deaths on his word alone. Rules can be invoked, institutional levers can be applied, but it still remains a rare individual who can make this proposition stick, not just on a consistent basis, but always. Something beyond gravitas is demanded. The appearance of supreme authority, a facade that ordinary people would never dream of disobeying. Generals are, by necessity, insular, exaggerated figures, deliberately magnified images for soldiers and henchmen, particularly during the quintessential moments of combat, but also pretty much always, enforcing the drudgery and inconvenience of military life with a smothering projection of personal authority. To do so, generals must necessarily live behind an artificial version of themselves, what the military historian John Keegan has aptly termed the mask of command. It is far from the only tool of a great military leader. Strategic wisdom, tactical skill, and bravery help a lot. But it is perhaps his best trick, an illusionary presence meant to inspire crazy self-sacrifice. Some are able to construct it around a single act of heroism, or some personal tic, or even a nickname. For others, it takes an entire career of careful calculation. In either case, the odds are the final product won't be that impressive. After all, the mask must empower the most difficult of all magic tricks, the levitation of entire armies into the cauldron of combat. But this did not prove a problem for our four principals. The masks they fabricated and inhabited are among the most beguiling in the history of organized mayhem. They literally moved millions toward life-threatening experiences. It would definitely stretch credulity to say that what separated our four from their peers was that they wore better, scarier masks. But there is a grain of truth there. Those who dismiss the mask's import should consider why both George Patton and Douglas MacArthur habitually spent hours looking at themselves in the mirror, or why Dwight Eisenhower changed uniforms with the regularity of a fashion model, or why even the low-key George...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.